Good morning, everyone, and welcome. Would you please stand for our call to worship? This is the word of the Lord from Romans chapter 10. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. This is the word of the Lord. Please join us as we sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Crown him with many crowns.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem shouts, all music by his
Would you please be seated?
Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone here as we gather together to do just that, to turn our eyes upon Jesus. And as we do that, at least for a few brief moments this morning, the world out there should just fade away as we are just overwhelmed by his glory and his grace. And so glad to see you all here today as we gather together, as I said, to worship God and to be reminded of the fact that he is holy and we are not. But compelled by his love, he has come into this world to rescue us through the person and work of Jesus Christ. And in him alone, we receive new, abundant, and eternal life. And that's the gospel. That's what we're all about here. That is the rhythm of life as we gather together as a family of God each week to worship him, and then we go. We are sent out into the world to live out that new life for the world to see. And we believe that that's possible only because of God's grace and power that comes to us through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we like to say here at LBC that we are transformed by the gospel to be rooted in Christ, connected in community, and engaged in mission. And so if you are joining us today for the first time, that's who we are. That's what we are all about, the gospel of Jesus Christ. My name is Dennis. I'm one of the pastors here. And on behalf of the entire church family, we would like to welcome you here this morning, whether you're here in person or whether you're joining us online today. And if you are visiting this morning, we would love to know that. We'd love to hear from you. So in the pew back in front of you, there's a small card called the Connecting Card. You can fill out some information on that for us and drop it in the offering, which will be going around later on in the service. Or if you have questions or comments or prayer requests, you can use that card to communicate that to us as well, or just email the church. The information and contact information is on the backside of the bulletin that you received as you came in this morning. And I have a couple of things I want to share this morning before we continue in our worship. First of all, today is Memorial Day, so happy Memorial Day to all of you as we celebrate God's gift of those men and women who are willing to lay down their lives for us as a nation. And so we are very thankful to God for that. And to celebrate that, we will be having our annual Memorial Day picnic today, immediately following the service. And so whether you remembered to bring a side with you, or this is the first time you're hearing about the picnic, come anyway. So after the service, if you just exit through the main entrance and head down to the pebble patio along the sidewalk, out the main doors and around the building, stay, grab a bite to eat, enjoy some fellowship with us. And again, that's immediately following the service this morning. And the second thing I want to remind you of, we've been talking a lot about some of the renovation that will be happening here at LBC. Well, it's beginning this week. You may have already noticed some things are moving around, like we have a welcome center in the back of the sanctuary. That'll be there for a little while yet. But this week, it starts in earnest. So two things will be happening this week. First of all, the parking lot will be getting sealed. So it'll be little bit hard to access the building for a couple of days this week, and at the end of the week, the tear out of the carpet will begin. And so when you come back next Sunday, there will be no carpet in the hallways or the main foyers. So the word to remember is pardon our appearance, because it'll be like that for probably about 4 weeks or so. So this week we'll be doing the tear out. The next 2 weeks we'll be doing the painting of the foyers and the hallways and fellowship hall. And then after that, we'll be doing the carpet install. So it's about a 4 week process. So excuse our appearance and be patient with us as we work through this. There's a lot of moving parts in that. And so anything else that's going on in church, I'd encourage you to check out our website. You can look on our welcome page. It'll tell you everything that's coming up in the weeks and months ahead. And now I'd like to read the call to confession from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Would you join me in prayer? Father, as I think about the seriousness of the gospel of Jesus Christ, as I think about the enormity of the work that you are doing in and through Christ, it can feel overwhelming. You are at work in Christ, reconciling all things to yourself, and you have sent us into the world to be a part of that work. Yet, Father, we confess to you that we are simply not up to the task. We confess that too often we remain silent when you open up opportunities to share our own story of salvation, to share what Christ means to us. Too often we represent our faith as if it's a work to do, not a work that has been done for us. We confess that too often as we look at the sinful world around us, we become judgmental. We become impatient, or we become fearful of the fallen world, forgetting that this is why Jesus has come. He has overcome this world. And so, Father, we ask that you would create in us hearts that love you and love others more and more each day. Create in us hearts that desire to share this Christ, the Christ that we have come to know, and to proclaim the gospel that has transformed our lives, and to share with everyone all that you have done for us, and to share with them the new life that we have only in him. And so we ask, Lord, that you would remove from us hearts that are self-seeking, remove from us hearts that are timid or distracted, and give us hearts that embrace the mission that you are on and the role that you are inviting us to play in that mission. We ask that you would give us hearts like Christ. We ask that you would give us hearts that are true ambassadors. Enable and empower us to represent Christ well to the world that so desperately needs him. And we pray it in his powerful and matchless name. Amen. Hear these words of assurance from Colossians chapter 1. And you, who were once alienated and enemies in your own mind by wicked works, yet now he has reconciled in the body of his own flesh through death, to present you holy, blameless, and above reproach in his sight. This is the work that God is doing. So let's stand and worship this incredible God.
Darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide.
Please be seated.
Good morning. My name is Bob Blanton, and I have the privilege to serve as one of the elders here at LBC. I'll be bringing us today's scripture reading from Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 through 6. I will be reading from the NASB 1995, Colossians 4, 2 through 6. Hear the word of the Lord. Devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving, praying at the same time for us as well, that God will open up to us a door for the world, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I have also been imprisoned, that I may make it clear in the way that I ought to proclaim it. Conduct yourselves with wisdom toward outsiders, making the most of the opportunity. Your speech must always be with grace, as though seasoned with salt, so that you will know how you should respond to each person. Please bow with me in prayer. Oh, be still our souls and know that you are God. You are the maker of the heavens and the earth. Lord Jesus, the wind and waves know your voice. And you have made us fearfully and wonderfully, so may our souls be still before you, knowing that because of the completed work of Christ, we have true and lasting peace, and that by the power of your Spirit, we can be fervent and continual in prayer. Forgive us, Lord, for growing weary and not being constant in prayer. Forgive us for not entering into our prayer with thanksgiving and gratitude of all that we have in Christ and all that you have done in order to guard and protect your church, but not only to guard and protect, but to advance the gospel, that the very gates of hell will be stormed by the truth and the power that those who are broken are redeemed, that the lost are found, that the weak are made strong, that those who are so, so broken have new life in Christ. Oh, Father God, may we be faithful to bring that gospel to bear throughout Monmouth County. We pray for those who are imprisoned and persecuted for this very gospel around the world. We pray that you would give them conviction and words of wisdom and grace about how to bring that gospel to bear to their fellow prisoners and captors. We pray for those of us here, Father God, in a country like the United States where we have the privilege of freedom of worship, Father. We pray that we would not take that lightly, that we would be strong and confident by the power of your Spirit to bring the gospel to bear. And we are mindful of the fact that we are able to do that because of your graciousness in blessing us with this country. And we know that that has even been a country that has been bought at the price of those who have served so faithfully, ultimately giving their lives. And so we thank you for the men and women through the years who have served in all different wars and conflicts to give their lives for this country. We thank you for them, and may we honor their memory, and may we honor the families of those who even now mourn the loss of loved ones given for this country, Father. May we be grateful stewards of the freedoms that you have bestowed upon us, and may we use those freedoms in order to advance the gospel, to speak clearly and graciously the plain words of the good work that has happened in us because of the Lord Jesus. And so, Father God, I pray that you would help all of us to identify those moments and those opportunities with coworkers, with neighbors, with families, with friends, maybe complete strangers, to tell of the hope we have because of the good news of Jesus Christ. I pray now that you would strengthen Chris. I pray that he would preach out an abundance of the overflow of his heart and the reflection upon the good news of what Christ has done. So Spirit, now work in him and through him. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to receive. All of this for the glory of the Father, by the power of the Spirit, because of the blood of the Lamb. Amen.
When I was growing up, my dad taught me how to change the oil on our cars, and we had all the equipment for it. We would roll the car up on blocks, and there was the thing you laid back on, the wheelie under thing is the technical term of that, to get under there, right? And you had the oil pans and all of that, and we did that a couple of times. But I have to be honest in that since I've become an adult, I've never changed my car's oil. I've only brought it in. Because I've known that, well, one, we live in a condo, so we don't have a garage for the equipment, but I know that the professionals will just do it better and faster than I could ever do it. But that's also kind of the culture and time that we live in, right? Like a expertise and expert culture, whether it's our cars or our taxes or our finances, we just outsource a lot of these things, our lawn care, to those that will do it for us, leaving it to the pros. But I think we just need to be careful as we reflect on and think about our faith and not just outsourcing our faith and the mission of God to the pros. Thinking like, well, you know, Pastor Chris, he's the professional Christian, and so he'll do all the spiritual stuff. Or Pastor Dan or Pastor Dennis or Bob, right? Up here, they're the professionals, and so they can handle talking about Jesus, sharing about Jesus, because it can be intimidating. We might think, well, I don't really know enough, right? Like the Bible's a big book, maybe you've never read through it all, or maybe what you've read you've had a hard time understanding at times. Maybe you think, well, I don't, like what if they ask me a question I don't have an answer for, and I get stumped, maybe that will make the church or the faith look bad. Or we think, you know, I don't want to be intolerant and talk about these things. So it can just be easier sometimes to outsource it and say, I don't really need to do anything with this. We'll leave it to the pros. But I just want to encourage you and to let you know that, you know, Jesus has given his mission to the whole church, to each one of us in here, not just me and not just you, but all of us together. We work together and we all have a role to play. After Jesus died and when he rose again, he was giving his final commission, his final sending to his disciples, who I believe represent the church as a whole. And he says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so Jesus has given this mission to share the good news of who he is, to love others and meet real needs in the world with all of us. With all of us. But here's the good news as well, right? When God gives you a job or a mission, he will give you the strength to do it. Jesus, in another time that he was talking to people, said, hey, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, tiny, tiny faith, you can say to this mountain, be uprooted and thrown into the sea, with just a tiny bit of trust in God. Jesus was not talking literally there. What he was saying was making the point is that there may be what looks like impossible obstacles in your life, but if you have God in your life, nothing is impossible with him. The smallest amount of trust in God can overcome the greatest obstacles. And so you may think that, well, sharing about Christ is beyond me. Making a difference in this world is beyond me. But Jesus says, with me, you can overcome these things because I am with you. And I think that this is greatly encouraging because your life is not an accident then. You are here for a purpose. God has a special purpose for your life that only you can fulfill for his mission. And it doesn't matter what age you are either. We are never too young or too old for God. I mean, he chose Abraham to have a kid beyond the time when human beings can have kids. But God worked through him. He removed that mountain. And so I don't know what's standing in your way this morning, but God is with you if you're in Christ. And your life has a meaning, it has a purpose. You are not here by accident, and you have a unique role to play in the mission of God. Some people are very good talkers for the mission of God. Other people are really good supporters. But everyone has a role to play, and we all can share our faith with others. That's what we've been talking about, really, is these core practices, right? These core practices for followers of Jesus. We've done a 4-week series. We've talked about reading the Bible, prayer, last week's, which was church. I preached last week. And now it's sharing your faith. These are core practices that, as followers of Jesus, make a difference in our life and help us grow in our faith. But how do we do this? Again, you can do this. You can participate in the mission of God right where you are with who you are. And Paul talks about this. See, I think this passage should be encouraging as well, because if anyone was a professional Christian, it was the Apostle Paul. He planted churches. He would go around in the Mediterranean preaching Jesus. People would believe it. They'd form a church. He'd instruct them, build them up, train them, and churches would start. That's what he did for his life. And yet he's writing this letter. This letter to Colossians is a letter to ordinary Christians like me and like you, to encourage us to step into the mission of God. You can do this. Here's how. 3 ways. Number one, pray. Sharing Jesus starts with prayer. Look at the text in verse 2. Devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving. Praying at the same time for us as well, that God will open up a door for the word, so that we may speak forth the mystery of Christ, for which I've also been in prison, that I may make it clear in the way that I ought to speak. I don't think that the author here is just saying, pray in general. Although he is saying that, we should be devoted and praying about all sorts of things every day. And prayer is merely talking to God. Talk to him. Like you may talk to a father or you may talk to a friend, talk to him. In the Bible, God speaks to us. And so Bible reading and prayer are often tied together. Do them together. Read your Bible. This is God speaking to us. And then we pray to God. Just talk to him. You can. But the prayer here, we have to remember the context of these verses. That's the most important principle for reading the Bible well, is what is the context? What's going on? And Paul is telling us, the author is telling us, pray, but it's all wrapped in this context of sharing Christ. So I think what he's encouraging us is to be devoted to praying earnestly for those who are not Christians, earnestly for opportunities to share the faith. He says, look, you need to pray, and by the way, in verse 3, pray for me as well. And what are they praying for? That God will open to us a door for the word, that we may speak forth the mystery of Christ. So Paul is saying, look, partner with me and pray for me that doors may be open that I can share Christ. But I think this is also a pattern for us. Some things to learn here from Paul, that he is praying consistently for opportunities to share his faith. You can do that. You don't need a PhD in theology to pray. You don't need to know like a ton of the Bible to pray. Just pray. Just talk to him. Read the Bible and pray. And pray for opportunities. He says that we may have a door opened to us for the word. What does that metaphor mean? It means an opportunity, right? An open door. Pray for an open door. Sometimes when we approach these things, though, and we pray about sharing our faith, we think we need to make a door, or we need to kick down the door, or we need to take the battering ram and break down the door. Sometimes we feel undue stress and pressure around these things of sharing Jesus, because we know that this is the mission of God, that we would make disciples of all nations, and we can believe that it's all on us. But Paul did not believe that. He's trusting that God will open the door. Sharing your faith is really God's work in your life and through your life, and you need to sometimes wait for the door to be open. You don't need to force it open, and you don't need to kick it down, but pray that God would open a door. And this is a test of faith. Do you believe that when you pray, stuff will happen? Do you believe that if you pray for opportunities, that they will come? I think that they will. And that's where prayer is the ultimate test of faith, because we need to trust that when we pray that God will open a door, that he will do it. But when he opens the door, Paul then says, pray that we may speak forth the mystery of Christ, for which I have been in prison, that I make it clear in the way I ought to speak. So what he's saying here is, look, pray for the opportunity, and then pray for boldness to take advantage of the opportunity. Think about a time, when was the last time in your life you knew you should have said something about anything? It doesn't necessarily need to be about Jesus, but about any issue, right? When was the last time there was an opportunity when you're like, you knew it in your heart, like, I need to say something here, and the words just didn't come out? So we need to pray for boldness as well, that when there is an opportunity, particularly to share about the love of Jesus for others and the gospel, that we would also be able to speak clear and speak about Christ. What I find so interesting here is that when he says, open up an opportunity, what is he speaking? He says, the mystery of Christ. In other words, he's just saying, I am preaching the gospel, the good news of Jesus, because that's what people really need, don't they? So let's not get caught up on other things. When other opportunities, yes, it's good to be informed about things and to apply scripture to a wide variety of issues, but let's just make sure that we're clear of what people really need is a confrontation and a conversation about Jesus, about who he is and what he's done for us on the cross, and that salvation is found in him. That's what Paul is speaking. So pray. Pray. That's the first way that we can really start to share our faith. And you can do this. You can do this. Again, you don't need to know the Bible cover to cover to pray. And you can pray for opportunities. Now, one of the common questions is, I get an opportunity. What do I say? What do I say? Right? This door opens to me. What am I going to say? And I think that one of these passages that Jesus was interacting and healing people is really instructive to us. So there's this time when Jesus, he's out and he's teaching people about the love of God, the kingdom of God, and there's a man who is born blind from birth, and Jesus heals this guy. And the religious elite of the day, the super holy religious people, the Pharisees, they did not like it because it was indicating that God's reign was breaking into the world and it was disrupting and disrupting the status quo, and it was saying that the Messiah essentially was here and it would dethrone them from positions of power and influence, and they didn't like that, and so they're going around to shut these things down. And so they keep pestering this blind guy. They actually don't believe him. When he says that he was blind and then healed, they don't believe him, and they go to his parents to double check their work, and they're like, yeah, he actually was born blind. So then a second time in John 9:24, a second time they called the man who had been blind and said to him, give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. This man is referring to Jesus. They're saying Jesus is a sinner because, again, they're feeling threatened by the healing power of God breaking into the world, disrupting their position. They know that this man is a sinner, and the blind man answered them and said, whether he is a sinner, I don't know. One thing I do know, though I was blind, now I see. That's what you tell people. In other words, what I'm saying is just share your story. Share your story about what God has done in your life. That at one time you were blind to the realities of God, but God's light and life broke into your life and opened your eyes to the glory and goodness of Jesus. That you experienced the love of God and the forgiveness of sins. Just share your story. And you know your story, right? You know this. You can do this. When you have an open door, share your story. What about if someone asks you a question that you don't know the answer to? You know what an acceptable answer is? I'll get back to you. I don't know. I'll get back to you. And then you can come and ask me or any of the pastors here. That's what we're here for. We want to help you. We want to guide you through these things. But it's okay. People understand that. It's better to say, I don't know, and I'll get back to you, than try to fake it. As if you're like some kind of expert, right? People appreciate the humility and the authenticity of saying, yeah, I don't know. Or that's a really good question. Let me get back to you. So when the door opens, walk through the door and share the love and goodness of Jesus. Share the message of that Jesus has forgiven your sins through the cross and he's living and alive again. So pray. That's where sharing your faith starts. And you can do this. You can pray. Number two, live wisely. He says in verse 5 here, conduct yourself with wisdom towards outsiders, making the most of the opportunity. So live wisely. What I love here is this emphasis that Paul places here on both the inward disposition that we are to have in sharing our faith, which is praying, talking to God. But then there's an outward disposition of living wisely. He says, conduct yourself with wisdom towards outsiders, making the most of the opportunity. Most of you, when you leave here, you're just jumping into a pool of people who are not Christians. The people you work with, the people you go to school with, the majority of the people in your life, they are not Christians. And we need real wisdom in how we live our life. And a key aspect of biblical wisdom is that it develops character and integrity. That the person that you are here on Sunday morning is the same person that you are on Monday through Saturday. That's what people are looking for. When you dive into that pool of non-Christians, and you're just around these people all the time, they may not believe in Jesus, but they're going to be wondering if you do. Right? If they begin learning like, oh, on Sunday morning I go to church, or oh, you know, I go to Bible study, or I'm part of small group. What's small group? Well, let me tell you. And they find out that you are a Christian, they're going to begin thinking to themselves, does this person actually believe what they say they believe? Are they living in line with their beliefs that they're talking about? Part of wisdom is growing in integrity and character. And so if you leave here and then Monday through Saturday, you're cursing all the time at work and you're yelling at your kids in the home and you are, you know, maybe not putting in like the best effort in school or at your work, cutting some corners, that's not good, man. It's not good. It's not good. Because you're testifying a different message with your life than with your words. And part of wisdom is consistency and integrity. You know, God criticized his people in the Old Testament. God criticized the people of Israel in the Old Testament, and he says, the Gentiles blaspheme me because of you. And so sometimes the only Jesus that the people around us may ever see or experience is found in us. And so are we living with wisdom towards outsiders? When you're around those who are not Christians, how is your behavior? Is it in line with the gospel, in line with Scripture? Are you loving and caring? Are you exemplifying the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, and self-control? Or are you manifesting the characteristics of a fleshly life, a life dominated by sin, which is immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, enmity, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, faction, envying, drunkenness, carousing, and things like this, as Paul says in Galatians 5. Living with wisdom means living with consistency, being the same person in church that you are out of church, or out of church that you are in church. Living with wisdom also means discernment, right? Discernment is knowing when to say something and when not to say something. When to do something and when not to do something. That's what living with wisdom means. Some of you are speak first, think later kind of people. Like Peter the Apostle was. And he just spouts his mouth off. And for some of you, learning wisdom is to know when the door is open. And that you don't always have to go in guns blazing. It says, make the most of the opportunity. So when an opportunity presents itself, are you discerning of when the door is open and what the most effective way to go in there will be? But some of you also need boldness, right? That's the discernment piece as well, knowing when to say something. And again, circling back around that there may have been times in your life when doors have been open and you could have said something and you didn't. So discernment is knowing when to say something, when not to say something, when to do something, when not to do something, and where to conduct ourselves with wisdom towards outsiders, making the most of these opportunities. See, again, this is all a test of our faith, because I truly believe that if you start praying for these opportunities, God will give them to you, right? He delights to have his mission move forward in the world. He delights to see sinners embrace Christ and get saved. Like, he may not answer your prayer for a bigger house or a nicer car or any car, but he's going to be very inclined to answer prayers of, Lord, give me opportunities to share Jesus with my family or my friends or my coworkers or just any opportunities in general. But this also places a little bit of a demand on how we live, that we live with wisdom. But you can do this. You can do this. This is not a call to completely upend your life, totally change everything. This is a call to live your regular life, but under the guidance of God. So you go to the same places, work the same job, be with the same people, but do it with wisdom, with consistency, with integrity, and with discernment. So pray, live wisely, and finally, number three, speak graciously. Sharing Jesus begins speaking with grace. He says here in verse 6, let your speech always be with grace, as though seasoned with salt, so that you will know how to respond to each person. Living for Jesus is important, but we also need to use words and share the love of God with others. Verbally share it. And he says here, let your speech always be with grace. I think what he's talking about here, what he means is two things. It's talking about what we speak and how we say it. What we say and how we say it. We need to speak with grace. So the opposite of speaking with grace is to speak in a vitriolic, grating, critical way. It's speaking in a way where we're cutting people down and we're trying to dunk on people or own people or make them feel stupid. That's not a gracious way to speak. We're not out to belittle people. We are not out to cut people down to size, but we are to speak with grace. That's how we speak. But we are the content of what we speak is also to be grace, which is the grace found in the Lord Jesus. that though we were sinners, God sent his own son to die on the cross for our sins and come back to life on the third day. Now this gift of salvation is held out to us, and we can receive it by faith, by trusting in God, but we don't need to do anything to earn it. In fact, we can't do it. We can't do anything to earn that gift. It's held out to us as a gift of grace. So we speak with grace, which means how we speak, but also what we speak. In other words, we're giving people the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he says, as we're speaking, we need to do in a way that it's as though our speech is seasoned with salt. Right? That we're sprinkling salt on our speech to make it tasty, to make it inviting. When you put salt on food, it draws out its natural flavors, but also what it does when you're crushing a bag of tortilla chips, what does it do? It makes you thirsty. It makes you want more. And so Paul, I think, is using this great metaphor to say that when we talk to people, we need to speak in such a way that it makes them interested in the Christian message, that it intrigues them in a way, and then we're able to give them the living water, which is Jesus himself. See, we speak with grace and we season it with salt that people might, their interest might be piqued. And then he says here, speak in such a way that you will know how to respond to each person. When you're responding to someone, what is the background to a response? Think about it for a sec. What's a background? Like if you have to respond to someone, what led up to that? A question, right? So people ask questions and then we respond. And I wonder if sharing our faith would seem a lot less intimidating if we just asked a lot more questions and invited more conversation than we thought about it as in terms of a sermon or a lecture, right? There's a place for sermons within the body, but maybe for you, it's asking a lot of good questions and stimulating conversation. Jesus asked a ton of questions to provoke people. It's like when he was interacting with the rich young ruler, or when he's interacting with the super holy religious people and they're asking, who is my neighbor? Right? And then Jesus tells these stories and he invites them into a dialogue together. But we're not dialoguing just for dialoguing's sake, of course, but we're having these conversations because we know the truth. And we're holding out Christ to people. But he's saying, you know, pray and think and ask the Lord, right, that you would speak with grace, that you would speak in a way that's intriguing to people, and then you will know how to respond and answer to people. Now, again, this doesn't mean that you have to be an expert on everything. You need to be an expert on the hope that is within you. That's what 1 Peter says in a passage that's very similar to this. See, I think one of the things that we worry about with sharing our faith is that if we start talking about Jesus, people will get angry. They may think we're intolerant or bigoted. And maybe it will bring some pressure and opposition into your life. And the answer to that is, yeah, probably. 1 Peter chapter 3 says, who is there to harm you if you prove zealous for what is good? So like if generally you are passionate about what is good, are people going to oppose you? Generally, no. But he goes on to say, but even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. So what this means is that you can be the kindest, nicest, most tolerant Christian around, and people still will not like Jesus in you. And you got to become okay with that. And he says then, do not fear their intimidation and do not be troubled, but sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts. Always be ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence. and keep a good conscience, so that in the things in which you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ will be put to shame. So what this is saying is that as the people of God, we are to go out and love the world, serve the world, meet real needs, and present Christ to the world. And even though we may do all the right things, there still may be opposition, there still may be people who don't like us, there still may be people who talk against us, and that's okay, because we need to have a firm hope in God and not allow us to sink down into the muck and the mire, because when you're opposed, one of the temptations is to hit back, to fight back. But that's not the way of Jesus. See, I don't like being beholden to the news cycle. If you've been around here for any length of time in our preaching and teaching, you know that we try not to, you know, be beholden to that. We want to be beholden to the Word of God. Let me just mention briefly, as I was reflecting on this text, one of the dynamics I've seen, right? And that is that Pride Month is coming, and this places enormous pressure on us as believers in multiple directions. And one of those directions is that is compromise, that we might celebrate and affirm things which God does not in His Word. We cannot do that. We should not do that. You know, on the other hand, though, we can still go out and love people and care about people and meet real needs, right? And be believers. And there's a difference between being called a bigot and actually being one. But then, right, if we're doing these things and people still may not like us, it can be a temptation to give up the speaking with grace. It can be a temptation to give up the gentleness and respect. So I think one of the things that we need to be centered on, right, is the gospel of Jesus and holding that out to people. Because look, if Jesus is still dead, why should anyone care what we think? Right? It's irrelevant. If Jesus is still in the grave, our faith is pointless. It's irrelevant. And so if you're considering the claims of Jesus, that is the central claim. Is he alive or not? And if you come down on answering that question, he's not alive, then I don't know why you would care what we think as Christians. But what if he is? If he is alive, and Jesus is who he claimed to be, which was the Son of God, who died for our sins and came to life after 3 days, then he is Lord of all. And as Lord of all, he says, pick up your cross and follow me. And for some people, that cross may be a crucifixion of their identity. That's hard. But see, the good news of the gospel is that that cross that Jesus calls you to pick up and bear, he bore for you first. That's why he died for you. And so, yes, the gospel message contains some hard things. And it may be a call for you to let some things die in your life. But Jesus died first for you. And this is a message of grace, that you can be forgiven and reconciled to him through his Son. And so now as believers that we've embraced this cross, we pick up our crosses and we follow him. We follow him. We walk worthy. Let's pray. Lord, you are the best news in the world. That everything we've done against you and against others, Lord, that can be forgiven. We can have a second chance, a fresh start. So, Lord, I pray that we would hold out that good news, that you lived the perfect life we have failed to live, and that you died in our place, taking the Father's wrath and justice for sin on yourself, so that we can go free. And Lord, you are now, you are risen, and you are sitting enthroned above all things. So may we hold out the hope that we have, that one day, just as you rose, we will rise too. Death is not the final answer. It's not the final word. It's not the end of everything, but it is just a gateway to life. Lord, entrench the gospel deeply in our hearts as your people, so that we may share Jesus with others, that we may give them what they really need, because you, Lord Jesus, you make all the difference. I ask this in his name. Amen.
Would those serving with the offering come forward? And just a reminder, you know, finances are important, right? As we all know, it's an expensive area of the world to live in, Monmouth County. It's no different for the church. And so we do appreciate your generosity, but as we take the offering each week, it really is just a response to many different responses to what God is calling us in life. And so whether he's calling you to give and give generously, or whether he's calling you to speak and speak boldly, whatever he's calling you to do, we do it out of an overflow of what he's already poured into our lives. He pours into us so that we can pour out into the world around us. And so this is just an opportunity to remind us in a very tangible way that the gospel is not just about God giving to us, but it's about God giving through us to the world around us. Would you join me in prayer? Father, we do thank you that you are an incredibly generous and gracious God. We stand before you, Lord, with nothing, empty-handed, but yet you give us everything that we need for life, for godliness, for an eternity together with you. And Lord, as you speak to us, I just pray that our hearts would be open to hear your voice and to respond to the grace that you are pouring into us. And so we ask that you would bless this offering, that you would bless the word that was preached today to take root in our hearts and to bear fruit for your glory. And I pray it in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Through eternal ages, let his praises ring.
Amen. Standing on the promises of God. Just a reminder, we have a barbecue right after the service, so I'm going to grab a cup of coffee and mingle for a while. That's fine, but I would ask that you go out the main doors and follow the sidewalk down to the pebble patio and not go down the hallway for security reasons for LBC kids. So hear this blessing for the road from Matthew chapter 28, one of the clearest expressions of the mission that we have been called on. This is what the risen, living Savior says. All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. For lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So go with the one who not only sends us, but the one who has all authority, and the one who goes with us. Go in peace.